First off, thank you for coming this afternoon. I know this is about the third time we've been interviewed in regards to this. We completed the autopsies, both of them, today. The person that's a suspect in this, his name is Michael, M-I-C-H-A-E-L, middle initial A as in Adam, Jarvis, J-A-R-V as in Victor, I-S, male, white, 48. Mr. Jarvis received two gunshot wounds via his own hand. It has been ruled a suicide. Our victim, as you know, is Dr. Todd Graham, 56 years old. Dr. Graham also received two gunshot wounds to the head. Now, we've been back out at the scene recovering video evidence from cameras out there, hopefully. We've also been back out to the scene of where Jarvis committed suicide. Right now, we just completed the vehicle of Dr. Graham. So evidentiary-wise, we're compiling everything. We have pretty much a picture of what went on and the story that goes along with it. I do want to sit down with the investigators in the near future here and compile everything as we know it to be at this point. If you have some questions, I'll answer as much as I can, and go ahead.
Is there any basic scenario you can share? I mean, was it a patient-doctor relationship?
Yeah, they did have a relationship. Anything to do with doctor stuff, Ken's going to handle, but they did have a relationship. They obviously knew each other. Again, yesterday, as I stated, this was a very targeted attack. I am a firm believer, and I think Ken feels the same way, that if Jarvis would have got inside that building, although there would have been a specific target, it's like trapping an animal in a corner, they're going to come out fighting. And I truly believe that this could have escalated into a mass shooting. I do believe that. I have to commend, again, the nurses, the staff at these facilities for doing exactly as they were trained to do. I absolutely appreciate all the help from all the departments. We had South Bend, Mishawaka County, as well as our unit, working in a cohesive manner to have the resolution that we have right now.
What can you tell us about the conflict that led to this shooting?
As I stated yesterday, I believe this is something that has built up over a period of time in Jarvis's head, and it culminated yesterday with this explosion, you know, in his mind, that he felt that this was necessary to end Dr. Graham's life. The confrontation, we believe, is going to be over pain medication. As I said, Ken will speak to that. I'm pretty much going to stick to the facts of the case, and the rest will be Prosecutor Cotter.
Can you talk about that?
Sure. Jarvis's wife went to see Dr. Graham, scheduled an appointment. During the course of that examination, Dr. Graham indicated to him, or to her, that he was not going to prescribe any opioid drugs. Jarvis became upset with that. Conflict and an argument ensued. It was Dr. Graham's opinion that chronic pain did not require prescription drugs. They separated, Jarvis and his wife. At some point, Jarvis came back. Dr. Graham, just before 1 o'clock, left the orthopedic building to travel to the rehabilitation building. During the course of that traveling, came in contact with Jarvis again. There was again an argument. Dr. Graham continued on to the rehabilitation building where he parked. Jarvis followed him, got out. There were two witnesses who were outside in a close proximity. Jarvis went to those two witnesses, told them to leave. They saw a gun. Jarvis then proceeded to shoot and kill Dr. Graham. Jarvis then left, went to his friend's home, gave indication that he was no longer going to be around. That friend contacted law enforcement, concerned for Jarvis's safety, and before law enforcement could arrive, Jarvis killed himself.
Was all this on the same day, the wife's appointment?
Correct. It happened at roughly 10:45, the original appointment, and then just before 1 o'clock, Dr. Graham was killed, and soon after, Jarvis took his own life.
This was over opioid drugs?
We're not sure. We have some indication. We're still gathering. We had obtained search warrants for all the medical records to get all of the previous meetings with Dr. Graham and Jarvis's wife. There are some indications that yes, it was, although not necessarily the appointment for Jarvis and Dr. Graham. It was for his wife and Dr. Graham. There's some indication that Jarvis may have also had his own issues. We're still investigating that. But make no mistake, this was a person who made a choice to kill Dr. Graham. This is not a fallout from any opioid epidemic or any opioid problems. This was a person who made that choice. That probably leads us into an examination of what is happening with the opioid problem in our community and frankly in our whole nation. I know that the Indiana State Medical Association is working very strongly on trying to address that problem, but today we're talking about a man who made a choice to kill another person. We're not talking about the opioid problem. That certainly is something we need to address. And was that a contributing factor in his decision? We don't know that yet. We have our own suppositions, but I don't want to talk about something that I don't know for sure. I do know for sure that Jarvis made that choice to kill Dr. Graham, and that's why we're here today.
That's how it began. That was the initial conflict. Had she been getting pills and he was cutting them off, or just wasn't getting prescribed?
No. She had not been prescribed opioids previous to that. This confrontation was Jarvis believing that his wife needed those opioid pills, and Dr. Graham's medical opinion was because of the chronic problem, he was not going to prescribe those. I mean, he did what we ask our doctors to do. Don't overprescribe opioids. And unfortunately, for whatever reason, Jarvis made that choice to take his life. Was that the only reason? Again, we're not completing the investigation, so I can't say that. Was that a contributing factor? There seems to be some indication it was.
Can you tell me if that's him?
I don't have a picture, so I can't tell you that.
Can't tell you that either.
Doctors should never get shot. Doctors are trying to do what they can to help people. And I think that's what's so tragic about this. Every homicide is tragic, but this one in particular, I think, hits home to everyone, hits home to all of our medical professionals. Their job is to try to help people. And that's certainly what Dr. Graham was doing. And for whatever reason, this man decided that he was going to take Dr. Graham's life. A tragedy is such an understatement of what happened. And I think that we're all suffering because of that. We all go to doctors and we're all trying to get help as best we can for our own pain and suffering. And for whatever reason, this person decided to take his life.
Was he a frequent flyer? Did he have a long criminal record? Really
can't talk about a person's criminal history. Anybody else? No, I didn't say that.
But both the husband and the wife were patients?
He was not currently a patient with Dr. Graham.
Was he a patient elsewhere that he might have been?
I don't know that information yet. We're still gathering as much as we can. This has been a pretty long 24 hours, and they're still gathering information to ensure that we have all of the facts. But at this point, I can't speculate. No, it was clear that she didn't know what he was doing. She's suffering as well.
She was surprised.
Oh, yeah.
Do you have any evidence that Michael Jarvis had a problem with opioids or was on opioids or needed one of the pills for himself?
Certainly
she
that.
Would get them and give them her?
Sure. That certainly that is a speculation. I don't deal in speculation. I deal in facts. So until I know for sure, I think it'd be inappropriate for me to try to comment on that. Is that a concern that we're looking into? Certainly. But we're looking into a variety of different things.
Were there any altercations between the two before yesterday?
There was a confrontation before, yes.
What was the nature of that confrontation?
We're still gathering that information.
Can you tell us anything about Michael, like where he works or what he does for a living or anything about him?
Really, with something like that, it's so insignificant in our investigation. That's so far down the line for us to even think about. We're concentrating on the things that we need to do to be able to prove the case. And I think in a lot of people's minds, these are automatic things that it's just so clear and it's so obvious, but that's not always the case. We have to follow this through as if this person was not dead and is on the run. That's why we did everything that we did. We've gone out and re-looked at everything, diagrams, everything. So it's just not, like I said to somebody today, we just don't ride in with our white hats and ride off. There's a lot of administrative things to do that are being taken care of.
Is it too early to learn something?
No, I don't think it's too early. I think that this has actually started a conversation. I've gotten calls from doctors. I've consulted with doctors in between when this happened and now, in trying to start a dialogue between the criminal justice community and our medical professionals to see how best we can, one, ensure as best we can the safety of our medical professionals, but also in treating if this is associated with the opioid epidemic, how we can best deal with that, what solutions we can have. I know that the Indiana State Medical Association is working hard on that. And I think that if this is part of that, this is a clear indication that it's not just a doctor issue, it's not just a law enforcement issue, it's our whole community issue, and certainly it's law enforcement talking with and helping our medical professionals so that we can best treat these folks.
Anybody else?
Any other questions?
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm.